Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Dolat Capital, we welcome you all to Q2 FY24 earnings conference call of Radico Khaitan. We would like to thank the management for giving us the opportunity to host the call. On the call, we have with us Mr. Abhishek Khaitan, Managing Director, Mr. Amar Sinha, Chief Operating Officer, Mr. Dilip Banthiya, Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Sanjeev Banga, President, International Business. We would like to congratulate the management for stellar 36% revenue growth in P&A segment and 49% in non-MFI segment. All the best for future endeavors. Let me now hand over the floor to Mr. Abhishek Khaitan, Managing Director, for his opening remarks. Thanks, and over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us on our Q2 FY24 results conference call. Strong growth momentum seen in quarter one was continued in the second quarter of FY24, with prestige and above category brands growing by 22% year-on-year. The growth was driven by all our core brands, such as Magic Moments Vodka, which crossed 1.5 million cases sales again during the quarter. Morpheus Super Premium Brandy, Royal Ranthambore, After Dark Blue Whisky, 1965 Spirit of Victory Rum, et cetera. This underscores the strength of our brand portfolio. Operational excellence and clearly defined strategic roadmap. Given the increasing premiumization, our margins have shown sustained improvement. We are making remarkable progress in further expanding our luxury brand portfolio. We launched the next two whiskeys in the Jugalbandi series of eight Indian single malt whiskeys. That is Jugalbandi No. 3 and Jugalbandi No. 4, at the Whisky Show in London, priced at 400 pounds per bottle. There is a lot of mysticism about India, and the global consumers are always intrigued by the Indian culture and heritage. With our Rampur Indian single malt portfolio, we have always strived to take India to the world. The recent launch is a testament to our brand creation capability and celebrates an ancient Indian art form. We are rolling it out to the U.K., USA, EU, Singapore, and global travel retail. Furthermore, we continue to expand the distribution of Rampur and Jaisalmer in India. Rampur is now available in over 10 states, and Jaisalmer is available in 20 states. With Rampur, we have surpassed FY23 volumes in the first half of FY24. Capitalizing on the growth in the white spirit space and our vodka market leadership, we are planning to launch a unique and premium pink vodka, made from 100% natural ingredients under the Magic Moments umbrella. We are quite excited about this product and confident that it will take Magic Moments portfolio to new highs. While we have seen prices of certain commodities stabilizing, the scenario remains volatile for glass and ENA. We continue to cautiously monitor the industry trends. Given the IMFL portfolio premiumization and price increases in both IMFL and country liquor businesses, we have seen our margins improve both on year-on-year and quarter-on-quarter basis. Although we have faced raw material pressure in the short term, but that does not impact the mid to long-term growth and margin trajectory. During the quarter, we successfully commissioned the new 350 kiloliters per day grain ENA distillery at Sitapur. The plant is now running at optimum capacity and achieved key operating parameters. The commissioning of the Sitapur plant not only secures long-term ENA supplies, but also positions us strongly to capitalize on the future growth opportunities in the branded business with enhanced bottling capacity. Together with the Rampur campus, the ENA production from Sitapur plant will be able to support the branded business growth for the next six to eight years. We are committed to our long-term strategy of delivering a sustainable premium volume growth. With our strong backward integration platform and dedication to brand excellence, we are confident in our ability to capitalize on the long-term growth prospects within the Indian spirits industry. We are focused on delivering a value-led growth, managing business with agility, harnessing the strength of our extensive distribution network and manufacturing platform, while we consistently improving our profit margins. I would now like to hand over the call to our CFO for a detailed operational and financial review. Thank you, and over to you, Dilip.
Thank you, Abhishek. Thank you, everyone, for joining us on this call today. During quarter two of financial year 24, we reported total IMFL volume of 6.96 million cases, which is a degrowth of 3% on year-on-year basis. Prestige and above category volume grew by 21.8%. In value terms, the prestige and above category registered 35.6% growth. During financial year 23, we had rationalized volume of certain regular category brands as a conscious strategic decision to mitigate input cost pressures. We have recently received price increases in the regular category in defense division. This should support us the volume in the coming quarter. Prestige and above category now account for 47.1% of the IMFL volume as compared to 37.9% in quarter two of FY23. The percentage of P&A is slightly higher due to the significant degrowth in the regular category. Improvement in IMFL realization is due to the combination of price increases and the continued premiumization. On year-on-year basis, there has been 165 basis point impact due to the price increase on our IMFL sales volume value. Gross margin improved significantly on year due to the price increases and ongoing premiumization in IMFL business. Coupled with price increases received in the country liquor business, on quarter-on-quarter basis, despite commodity inflation in ENA and grain prices, we have been able to sustain our gross margin. Although prices of certain packaging material have softened recently, we are cautiously monitoring the trend of ENA and glass bottles where volatility still persists. Overall, we have a strong financial position and comfortable liquidity. During these times, we are taking all necessary steps to sustain our financial strength, maintain robust business model, and grow consistently, competitively, and profitably. With this, we will now open the lines for Q&A.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The first question is from the line of Harit Kapoor from Investec. Please go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon. I had two or three questions. First was on the new plant. So can you just give us a sense of what is the kind of capacity utilization that will be for your own brands and what amount of capacity will be utilized for selling outside in terms of bulk alcohol, at least for the first say 6 to 12 months. If you could give some sense on that.
So the Sitapur plant has been commissioned keeping in view the strategic angle in mind. This plant is having a capacity of 350 kiloliters per day. So initially this is being used for our branded business where we were stock and block, and as you see, our brand business, particularly the P&A category growth, is in the strong double digit. Some of the ENA, grain ENA, will be used for our UPML, which is a new segment introduced in Uttar Pradesh this financial year. Rest of the ENA, for the time being, will be either sold to the local manufacturer or exported out of India. But with our business model, we are confident of achieving that our captive utilization in next 3 to 4 years.
Okay, understood. This, the second thing was on the popular segment. So, you know, you've seen as the industry has also seen, you know.
Sorry, but your voice is not coming clearly. Can you please speak with the handset? Hello, Harith, we have lost you.
Hello, is this better?
Yeah, yeah. You can carry on.
Yeah, yeah. So, my second question was on popular. So, you know, you've seen an impact there in the last a few quarters. You know, just wanted to get a sense whether this is in certain states where the pressure is more, or, you know, how are you seeing it, you know, the outlook for this segment going forward? Do you think volume stabilize at these levels? Just wanted to get your outlook on that.
So, in general, the regular category or the popular category is having a muted growth as far as the industry is concerned. Certain states which are big states like Karnataka increased the duty by 20%. There is an impact on the demand at that price point. And UP, where there is a difference between UPML and regular categories higher, there is some downtrending. But this actually, and as far as defense is concerned, we got the recent price increases, and I think that will be arrested in Q3. Some export market where the currencies have been depreciating against dollar, there also the regular category brands are having less saliency. And because of that, there is a degrowth in general in the regular category. But I think as far as Redico's business model is concerned, we will be able to come on the flat basis to some low to mid-teens, mid-single-digit volume growth in the coming quarter.
Got it. And Dilipji, you mentioned the price increase in candy. So how much is that happened?
So overall, in that price category, around 6%.
Okay, I have some more questions, but I'll come back. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. Next question is from line of Abneesh Roy from Nuvama Institutional Equities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. So we are seeing a very strong mix change which is happening in your business. X of Karnataka, where is the consumer going? Because such a sharp dip in the regular category in the lower end, obviously consumption will not happen so drastically in terms of change. So obviously, that consumer is going to other brands. For a lot of the multinational companies, this is a very conscious strategy. So in your case, how much of this mix change, dramatic mix change, is conscious strategy, and how much is a risky proposition from medium long term, given consumer will shift to other and possibly the local brands?
So in general, as I said, in this category, the industry is also very, very muted to flat kind of thing. Secondly, these are the two states which I talked about, which are larger ones, but there in general, this is small, this thing. And secondly, degrowth. And secondly, as I said, that our focus is P&A and above. So strategically, where there is an input cost pressure, there has been a cut down as a strategic call. So I don't think that is our focus, and I think that will come back where we got the price increase.
Okay, understood. And in terms of the advertising and more so surrogate advertising, could you take us through, because you are doing so many new products at the P&A level, especially in whiskey, where traditionally there are other players who are having the higher market share. Could you take us through how that spend will pan out in the coming quarters? Because now Q3 clearly is a festival quarter, but more from a 1 to 2 years perspective, how do you see your ad spends panning out?
So see, as far as our ANSP spends are concerned, we feel that despite all the new brand launches, we will continue to be within 6 to 8%. However, when we are right now launching new products, what we are right now focusing on is a lot of on-ground visibility and consumer trials, which will continue for at least the next 1 year. On a selective basis, for brands like Magic Moments, we are continuing with our initiatives on in-film brand integration. For premium brands, We are, like for Royal Ranthambore, we are concentrating on golf. So we are picking up events as a prime source for above line advertising rather than working too much onto the surrogate route. Events is something that's currently being allowed. And if you see the World Cup matches, also practically every liquor company is there. And we are following the event route right now. So I don't see this as a big problem. We have to be a little creative, and the strength of Radico has always been in innovation and creativity for our brands, which we will continue.
Sure, thanks. That's all from me. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask the question. Next question is from the line of Pankaj Kumar from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thanks for taking my question, and congratulations on a very good set of numbers. Sir, on question is on gross margin that we have seen, even the sequential basis, it has improved, though there is a pressure, you said, and the volatile scenario on the raw material prices. So I want to understand what benefit we have got from the backward integration in terms of gross margin contribution for this quarter and going ahead.
So we have improved on our gross margin on year-on-year basis by around 260 basis points, and on a quarter-on-quarter basis by 60 basis points. It is on account of the premiumization and price increases. The higher-end products like Royal Ranthambore, Jaisalmer, Rampur Indian Single Malt are having a big traction, and the percentage growth in these segments are much higher. We have been able to mitigate this cost pressure. There has been an increase on broken rice or this thing by around YOY basis around 15%, on a quarter-on-quarter basis also by 4%. Last year, two price increases in the glass bottle has eaten away on a gross basis a margin around 225 to 250 basis points. So in spite of that, the margin improvements are there consistently. And I think on commodity side, the season has started. We expect from November end to December, the commodity should also have some softening, and which will have a tailwind to our margin. I think we will continue to improve.
Okay. And sir, because now this backward integration, that benefit will also be coming in. So we'll see that will be adding your gross margin, and any outlook, any commentary on that, if you can comment.
Yeah, so backward integration will definitely add on to the gross margin, but at the same time it will add to my branded portfolio more, which will be a value-added product.
And the second question is on your overall capacity. So on the bottling side as well as the ENA side, so now with this expansion, so how much we are utilizing in-house in terms of ENA supply, and in the bottling also, how much is the in-house versus contracted in-house?
As far as the ENA is concerned, now we are self-sufficient for our 100% of the branded product and UPML or CL. But the point is, on logistic reason, some of the states in southern and all that, which are distant away, we buy the alcohol for a popular product, and to that extent, there is a buying of ENA. As far as the bottling capacity is concerned, we have a very large bottling capacity now at Sitapur. So we will be sufficient for our own bottling. And I think our own bottling at this point of time is around 55% or between 55 to 60%. And the third party bottling is around 45 to 40%.
And sir, my last question is on the volume growth outlook for the P&A side. We have seen the more than 20% volume growth in the first half. So how do you see for the second half and for FY25, any commitment?
So we have always been talking about P&A as our focus area, and we continue to focus and have a strong double-digit growth on our P&A category for next 2 to 3 years.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. Next question is from Lanav Jay Shah from OHM Portfolio Equity Research. Please go ahead.
Hi, am I audible?
Yeah, please carry on.
Congratulations for a good set of numbers. I just wanted to understand that gross margins of 44% and EBITDA of 13%. Is this the new normal now, given, you know, the past volatility where we had a couple of issues hitting us?
So, as far as our business model is concerned, we are confident about improving these margins year after year. At the same time, as I said, that these commodities like the soft commodity of grain and ENA and glass prices, I can't have a visibility more than. So if it remains at steady state at these levels and all that, then we will improve on our gross margin as well as the EBITDA margin, giving our premiumization and product portfolio.
Yeah, and you also have the backward integration benefit kicking in.
Yeah, yeah, that's part of the whole business model.
Right. And secondly, this prestige and above sales, you know, which is already 64% of IMFL, so effectively 50% of company revenue. Where can this peak out? I know your focus on strong double-digit growth, but does it peak out at, say, 60-70% of the company revenue? How should we look at it?
So this quarter, there has been a double impact. One is the regular has degrown by 15% or so, and this has grown by 22%. That's why the mix of that is around 47% in volume terms. However, as our business model further going forward, we expect that the P&A in a normal state where it grows the mid-low digits by the regular and P&A in double digits, we will be in the range of 55 to 60% on volume terms in the T&A category. Next, in 2 to 3
okay.
years.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's all. Best wishes.
Thank you. Next question is from line of Kaustubh Pawaskar from Sharekhan by BNP Paribas. Please go ahead. Kaustubh, may I request you to unmute your line and go ahead with the question, please?
Yeah. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, sir. Thanks for giving me the opportunity and congrats for good set of numbers. So my question is on the debt front. So now the major capex has been done. The factories are now operational. So, a timeline when we can see, you know, substantial reduction in debt, since we are expecting cash flows to improve over the next 1 to 2 years. So any thought process on that?
So yes, the major capex has already been done and commissioned. We have already guided that we will continue to, the debt will be peaked in the Q3 of this year, and then thereafter there will be continuous declining in the debt, and by 2026, and it will be a very negligible kind of debt with the business model.
Right, sir. And so talking about the EBITDA margins, we have seen sequential improvement in the EBITDA margins. This quarter, the margins stood at around 13%. And we have guided that by end of FY24, margins should be close to around 14 to 15%. So considering the strong performance of P&A, segment, should we expect, margins, EBITDA margins coming close to around 15% by end of FY24? Also, the full benefits of,
as I said, that margin from here onward will continue to improve. And we have already said that I think every year the margin improvement trajectory will be seen. By 3 years' time, it should be a kind of late teens kind of margins. That is we are expecting.
Right. And the full benefit of the Sitapur facility should start playing in from FY25. Is it the right understanding?
Come back again, please.
Full benefit of commissioning of Sitapur facility would start flowing in from FY25. So that would further support your margin.
So full capacity utilization of Sitapur will be there as far as the distillation is concerned in Q3 also, and next year it will be a full year.
Okay. Thanks for that.
Thank you. Next follow-up question is from the line of Harit Kapoor from Investec. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I just had one follow-up. The operating costs for the quarter, do they have an element of, the Sitapur, plant having, commissioned and actually revenue hasn't come into that extent, but costs would have come in. I just want to understand, will the revenue and cost kind of match in from Q3 onwards, a little upfront in Q2?
So, Arun, Sitapur came into operation in the last 10 days of the current quarter two. And next quarter onward, there will be top line also from that, and the full expenditure will also come into the P&L. So, yes, it will be seen in both.
No, so just, you just wanted to check that, if the employee costs or some of the other costs come in a little bit before, so that impact would have come in Q2 to some extent, and revenue would have just, would have lagged a little bit in Q2. I just wanted to see if there isn't any extra cost coming in on Sitapur, which will obviously get matched by revenue in Q3.
So from here onward, the interest, depreciation and all that will be charged out, and I think you will see, as I said, I can say only this, with this business model and integrated business model, with the Sitapur coming into full operation, we will continue to improve on our margin, because there will be backward integration benefit also, and the premiumization which is going on will continue to further strengthen.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Anurag Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Congratulations on the excellent quarter for the premium and above segment. It's a record quarter for the segment, and with sales touching almost 500 crores. And the P&A sales have almost doubled in last 3 years, which is significantly ahead of the industry. Now, comparing, the regular segment has been the lowest sales in last 5 years on a quarterly basis, barring the COVID lockdown quarter. Now, from the previous questions, I gather that there are two reasons. One is at the industry level, and second is management's own evaluation that the sales in regular segment will not be margin accretive, so you have probably given up those sales. So now, based on these two factors, what would explain the decline, like 50-50, or which is the larger reason for the decline in volumes in the regular segment between these two factors?
As I said, one, industry, I can't have the division or the separation between that what is on account of the industry and what is on account of this thing, cost push. But yes, of course, we are doing the regular segment in certain states where we make reasonably okay margin. A certain state where it is very, very minuscule or negative, I think we are doing away with those volume. So I feel like that because cost push is across, and like defense has given the price increase this at the end of the last quarter, Q2, certain more markets will give the price increases in those areas. Then as the industry is concerned, industry is growing in mid single digits. So we will continue to come on that in next year. This year in H2 also will be like flat to some growth.
All right, sir. Thank you. And I have one more question on the export segment. How has been the performance of the export segment? And for Radico, is now the export segment bigger than its largest state or not?
Well, in terms of export, we've been doing fairly well. We are, in fact, one of the largest exporter of IMFL from India. And we are seeing increase in the acceptance of our brand, especially the luxury portfolio across the world. There have been a few issues in certain markets because of the local currency situation, but I think overall we continue to keep growing.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to all the participants, you may press star and one to ask the question. Next question is from Sneha Jain from SKS Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. I just wanted to know the impact of the RM prices, like, I mean, what are the trajectory you're seeing them to go to, and what are the major RM prices that we are seeing being impacted, and anything, like any sort of recovery or something like that from that?
In the raw material, the major raw material is grain. And as I said, that grain prices on year-on-year basis are up around 15%, on quarter-on-quarter also 4 to 5%. But all this thing shows that the crop in the northern part is good, the export has been banned and all that. So we see some softening as the mills processing and all that come on full swing. Said that November and onward, when there is a season, for 3-4 months we should see those prices to decline. And the major impact on account of the ENA is also on account of that. We have seen in ENA also 7 to 8% inflation on year-on-year basis, around 2% inflation on quarter-on-quarter basis. This is a major raw material. Rest all are the hard material is under softening side. The glass prices is already said that that has risen and 30-35% last year, and that is also an impact of around 225 to 250 basis on my gross margin. But it's
and glass prices continue to be like
now it's stable. Now it's stable. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Nirav Seksaria from Living Roots Analytics. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So I just wanted to know, going forward, how much revenue mix are we expecting from regular since we are focusing on premiumization?
Regular mix, right now it is around 45% versus 55% in this thing. As I said, our growth strategy is on the P&A category, where we will have a strong double digit. In 3 years' time, if we are able to do 60% of volume from P&A and 40% volume from the regular category, I think there is that business model will be a stable business model.
And so there have been introduction of several gin brands at various price points. So how is the sales of Jaisalpur doing?
Yeah, you are not audible.
Could you repeat your question, please?
Yeah. There are several new gin brands entering into the market. So how is the sale of Jaisalpur doing on a comparative basis overall?
See, if you compare to all the Indian brands, like Jaisalmer is pitched against the highest selling global gin brands, and Jaisalmer is priced at about 4,000 rupees a bottle. And in that segment, today we are the leading market share, and our market share would be close to about 55%. And Jaisalmer, everywhere, wherever it's gone, it's doing exceptionally well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
And in fact, we've launched recently Happiness Gin at about 2,000 rupees a bottle, 2,000 to 2,200 rupees a bottle. So that would be the gin which would be competing with the Indian local gins.
Okay. And what is the outreach for the Happiness front?
Pardon?
What is the reach for the Happiness, like in how many states is it available?
So this quarter, we are going to roll it out in about 5 states. And gradually next year, we'll take it pan-India. So this quarter, we are rolling it out.
So which 5 states is it going to hit?
The voice is completely...
Yeah.
Can you repeat, please?
Definitely. Much better now?
Yeah, I speak.
Yeah, I'm asking which 5 states is the Happiness brand going to enter?
So we are looking at states like Haryana, Delhi, Goa, Rajasthan, and UP.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Himanshu Shah from Dolat Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah.
Thank you. So just a couple of questions. First is our capex on the greenfield expansion of Sitapur complete, or there will be some additional spend that will come up in H2 FY24 for Sitapur plant?
So Sitapur plant capex is all complete. It's a complete, but some of the payments which comes after, because these are after the performance and all that, will come in H2 also. There are certain capexes which has been done by the company. This has been to do our the happiness. We had had a new Zinn facility commissioned for that. We have tripled our capacity on the Jaisalmer also. So these kind of capexes, we have improving on our printing bottle capacity by around 33-35%. That will also come into play in this thing in coming year. So all these capexes are now being done on the branded business side, and in particular the P&A and luxury brand.
Okay. So in this backdrop, can you guide for our capex number for H2 FY24 and FY25?
So H2, the remaining capex payment side will be around 125 crores next year. I think the capex will be in the range of around 75 to 100 crores.
Okay, and henceforth, capex run rate should be in that vicinity, 75 to 100 crore?
Yes.
Okay, and 125 crores for H2 is only the payment pending, but we would have capitalized that particular amount. Is that...
No, payment pending is one part, and another, as I said, that these capexes which has been done for our premium, super premium and luxury side. We are increasing our maturation facility. There will be more cask required. So all this will continue to happen on the mall side also.
Brand related.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. This is very helpful. So secondly, if you can just help, what would be the market size of vodka and gin? This is the growth run rate that we have seen in first half of the financial year. Or what would have been the overall market size of vodka and gin for this particular financial year, industry size, some color if possible?
See, overall vodka market is in 3.5%, like it is 400 million cases industry, so something 10 million cases, 10.5 million.
So the vodka market is about 3% of the total IMFL business in India. We are actually growing at a very healthy rate and expanding the vodka segment with our new offerings, which will continue.
Okay. And what about gin, sir?
Gin is negligible at the moment.
See, gin right now is quite negligible, but it is growing at a rapid pace, and especially like the premium gin. Gin is more at the premium side. So their volumes are quite small, but... the profitability and the contribution is very high.
Okay. And so just the last question, can you help me with the distribution of Royal Ranthambore? Like, it's available in how many states, Jaisalmer, Gin, and these two products?
So Royal Ranthambore has expanded to about 18 states, and the response to the brand is unprecedented. Though we have priced it higher than the most popular selling scotch, the brand is well accepted, and we are now gearing up our capacities to cater to the market demand that is emerging for this brand. I think this is a future brand for Radico with unprecedented response.
Okay. That's very nice and very heartening, sir. And about Jaisalmer Gin, sir, and if you can also help me with 1965 rum, number of states that it's available.
So Jaisalmer Gin is in about 19 states. We are national brand. We are a national brand both for Jaisalmer Gin and Royal Ranthambore. As far as Jaisalmer Gin is concerned, Mr. Abhishek Khaitan has already told you, we are today in the region of about close to 60% market share across the gin category. And this brand is showing unprecedented results also, despite being highly higher price premium to most international brands. we are very hopeful. We are tripling our capacity. We have tripled our capacities as well. So I think Jaisalmer has a future in India. 1965 is in about 10 states. It is the most premium priced rum in India today. You see, it's rum has traditionally been seen as a cheap and medium priced product in India. But with the launch of 1965, starting with defense, it was pegged at a premium price. Now it has been expanded to the civil domestic market as well. We are in 10 markets in domestic. We hold more than 10% market share in defense. The brand is consistently growing, and I think 1965 will become synonymous with the category in the years ahead. It's showing tremendous response.
Oh, sir. Great. Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot. I appreciate it. That's it from my side.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Jay Shah from OHM Portfolio. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the follow-up opportunity. I have two industry level questions. First is, do we expect any volatility in the liquor policy because of the state elections and the central elections, whether Delhi things are settled down? And secondly, can you comment on the impact of UK FTA if it goes through on Radico? Thank you.
Let me first talk about the UK FTA. I think as an industry and especially as Radico, we welcome this FTA as and when it happens. Also because we import a lot of bulk scotch. So any duty reduction will definitely make a good impact on our costing as well. In terms of overall industry, the more scotch malt is available at competitive prices, will definitely improve the quality of Indian blends as well. And with India premiumizing the portfolio in the beverage alcohol space, so even the international brands, when they come in, there will be a big boost to the industry and the P&A category. However, our want has always been that it should be a level playing field. So the British side would also have to do away with some of the non-tariff barriers. Once that happens, the export of IMFL and Indian whiskey and rum will also increase substantially to the UK market.
And as far as the first question goes about the state elections and everything, I think one of the major decisions which took place was removal of ENA under GST. Which the GST committee took, which I think is a very welcome move for the liquor industry. This ambiguity was there for 2 years, which has been done away with. And we don't see much of any policy change because of these state elections. In fact,
the state governments are very responsive to the liquor business because it's a state subject matter. So state elections will not disturb the policy and there would be stability like always.
Thank you. Just a follow-up on the UK FTA. I thought since we are more into the prestige and above category, aren't the product pricing benchmark to the foreign brands like a Glenlivet and whatever it is, and hence some kind of a pricing impact that may happen?
In terms of our luxury portfolio, say Rampur, is way above the Glenlivets of the world or the Shivas and some of the other 12-15-year-old Scotches. So Rampur is far above that. And even in the global international market, we are competing with all these brands at a much higher price level. So we don't see a problem with that.
But with the vodka, gin, and the other ones, I mean, Rampur, Jaisalmer may not be, but the other brands.
No, I think it's very important to understand that Radico has already breached the international brand's price positioning, whether in India or abroad. We are selling at higher price points. And we don't see any competition coming to our brands in the immediate future, even despite FTA.
Secondly, as far as gin and vodka is concerned, there will not be any impact of the duty reduction because the thing is everything is locally made for the gin and vodka. Thank you. I'll take it offline. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As there are no further questions, I will now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
So we are confident of maintaining our long-term margin expansion given the premiumization of our portfolio. Recently received price increases both in IMFL and non-IMFL, and backward integration will further strengthen this. We look forward to integrating with you on all in our next earning call. In the meanwhile, if you have any queries, please follow up with us and feel free to write to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Dolat Capital Market Private Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. You may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.
Okay.